month, and I think that's part of what we've been talking about, is we have no fear as Christians about what may lie ahead, even if we don't know what's coming. We know that Jesus is there, amen? The rest we can only imagine. All right, Steve, thanks for fixing my microphone, buddy. We are in the book of Joshua this morning, if you have your Bibles. Go ahead and lift them up this morning, let's see. Okay, Joshua chapter 1 is where we're going to be this morning. I turned on my mic, guys, so if you need to make any adjustments, go ahead. You might see I also wore my colorful tie this morning. It's a scarlet and gray, in case anybody was wondering. You can imagine one. Well, it is good to be here this morning, good to see all of you. And we are concluding our series, as I talked about a moment ago, on Whom Shall I Fear? We do not need to fear anything. As Christians, we don't need to fear what? Temptation. We don't need to fear struggle. We don't need to fear what ghouls and goblins may come this week as the world celebrates Halloween. And I've seen different points of view on Facebook this week, especially as we approach this strange American holiday called Halloween. But what kind of inspired this series this week, this month, because we want to talk about the fact that we don't have anything to fear. We do fear a lot, though. We fear death. We fear cancer. We fear the struggles of life that we go through sometimes. But we don't have to. We've talked about the fact that we need to fear only one thing, and that is what Proverbs tells us, and that is the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom and understanding. Jesus also tells us in the Gospels that we shouldn't fear the one that can harm the body, but that which can harm the body and the soul, and that is Satan. The only reason we need to fear him is if we are willing to give in sin and temptation. Otherwise, we know that the Bible tells us when we resist the devil, he does what? He does the fear. He flees. When we resist the devil, he's the one that takes off running. Okay? So, we don't need to fear much of anything as Christians, except we have a fear and a reverence and an honor of our Lord and Savior. So as we conclude, though, this morning, I'm going to encourage you out of the book of Joshua, that God was talking to Joshua and telling him, have no fear. Before we do that, though, let's have a word of prayer. Our Father God in heaven, we come before you in the name of Jesus this morning. We thank you for this another day of life. God, we're thankful for the love and grace that you bring into our lives, Father, the fact that we don't need to fear anything. Whom shall I fear? We have Jesus on our side. God, we thank you for the love of Christ. We thank you for the protection that he brings. Father, for the fact that we can look to you and find peace and comfort from the world's storms. We don't have to fear the storms of life. We don't have to fear the drama. All we have to do is trust in you. Lord, we do that this morning. Father, I pray that you would be with us as we look at your word in Joshua and find out that there is encouragement that comes from you, Father, as we take on battles of life. Lord, we love you, and we give this time to you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, we're going to be in Joshua chapter 1 this morning, looking at verses 7 through 9. And many of us may not fear much. I understand that. We've been talking about this series, and we've had our time in Sunday school and things, and people will tell me, well, I don't really fear death. I don't really fear much of anything. And I think we put on a brave face sometimes. I think we want to let others know that we have no fear. But down deep, sometimes I think there is a battle waging within us. Paul even said, my flesh wars against the spirit in a battle for control. The flesh is what brings us fear. The flesh is what brings us failure. And there is a battle that continues within me to this day. As a preacher, as a pastor, as an evangelist, as a man who wants to encourage others in the Word, a man who tries to raise others in the Word, as a man who is a husband and father, I still battle to this day in the flesh. We all do. Sometimes that brings us fear. But this morning, as we look at the example of Joshua, we want to see that God is going to encourage us not to fear, but to, in fact, give everything over to Him and let Him do the work for us. Joshua chapter 1, verses 7 through 9 is where we are this morning. And God reveals something important to Joshua and to us this morning. Let's go ahead and read there, beginning in verse 7 this morning. God is talking to Joshua, and He says, "Be strong. Be strong and very courageous. Be careful to obey all the law my servant Moses gave you. Do not turn from it to the right or to the left, that you may be successful wherever you go." Verse 8, "Do not let this book of the law depart from your mouth. Meditate on it day and night, so that you may be careful to do everything written in it. Then you will be prosperous and successful. Have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not be terrified. Do not be discouraged. For the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go." Does that encourage you this morning, church? We understand that there are times in our lives that great responsibility is laid at our feet. There are times in our lives when things are laid at our feet that maybe we don't want to deal with, yet there it is. There are times in our lives that we have to work really hard, even to get through the day. And folks, this morning, as we look at the example of Joshua, we see that if you look in the previous part of the chapter there, the beginning of the book of Joshua, Moses, the leader of the nation of Israel, has passed on. Joshua is the next man in line to take on the leadership of the children of Israel. Church, if you know anything about them, they're not an easy people to deal with. If you look very fast forward up into the book of Acts, chapter 7, we see that Stephen, the deacon, even says himself that the nation of Israel was a stiff-necked people, right? Just as an example there. But Joshua is the next in line to take on. He is becoming the president, the leader, whatever you want to call him. He is the next man in line. He is the one who's going to lead the people into the promised land. We know that Moses was able to lead the people up to the border, but was not able to pass in because of his sin. So now Joshua is up next. He is the man who's got the job. And I can imagine that he is not completely excited about it. He's been there. He's been there through the tough times. He's seen what Moses has had to deal with over the years with the nation of Israel. He knew what happened when the nation sinned. He was one of the 12 spies that went in to the promised land to spy out the land. But he was only one of two that said, "We can do this." The rest of them, the other 10, said, "No, we can't. We can't take this on. We can't do this." And what did the people do? They listened to the 10 who were negative. They didn't listen to Joshua and Caleb, who said, "We can do this. We can take the nation. It's no problem." So Joshua's been there through the tough times. He's seen Moses die now, and he knows that this is now the time for him to step up and take on the mantle of leadership. And I imagine he's got some tremors. I imagine he's got some trepidations. I imagine he's thinking, "Am I up to the task?" And God steps in this morning in the middle of Joshua chapter 1 and says, "Joshua, you can do this because I'm with you." And we understand the idea that Joshua was ready to fill Moses' shoes was a frightening proposition. But when God says you can do this, get ready. Because Joshua understood after the message was given to him in the first chapter here that he was going to do the work, and that God was going to lead him and take him on through what was many, many battles as they began to take over nation after nation in the promised land. And at the end of his days, Joshua would say, "As for me and my house, we will what? Serve
the Lord.
Joshua began to take on the leadership of the nation of Israel with a little bit of fear. But at the end of his reign, as he gave up the mantle, he said, "As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord." He learned what it meant to follow God's leader. But let's break down the passage this morning as we look into it. Two times in just these three verses, God tells Joshua to be strong and courageous. In fact, in verse 7, he says not just be courageous, he said what? Be very courageous. Okay? Again, there are times in our lives we're going to be looking at things. Things are going to fall into our lap, or we're going to have problems in our lives, and we're going to look to God, and he's going to say, "Hey, what? Be strong. Be courageous." You know why he can say that? Because he's God. Because he sees ahead what only he can see. He sees ahead only what he can do. We know that when we are weak, the Bible says what? He is strong.
That's right.
In our weakness, he is strong. When we don't think we can get the job done, guess what? Here comes the Lord and says, "Hey, we're going to do this together. We're going to make this happen. We don't have to fear anything because I'm with you." Right? Church, God is with us no matter what we do, no matter where we go. The Lord guides and gives us life. David tells us over and over again, I think I quoted this passage already this month in the Psalm. He tells us that the Lord and his word are a lamp to our feet and a light to our path. God guides us in his word. His word is hidden in our hearts, see, right? So that we may not what? Sin against God. Okay? His light guides us, church. His light gives us hope. His light is what we follow. And the advice God gives to Joshua this morning to calm his fears as the new leader of the nation of Israel is very practical for us today. In fact, I want to point out three things this morning that I think really stand out for us, and they really have to do with what we just talked about, and that is God's law, his word. Three things he commands Joshua to do in these short verses here. Number one is this, verse 7. He says, obey what? All the law. Right? God tells Joshua, and I'm telling you this morning, the very same thing. We are to obey all the law. God didn't tell Joshua to obey some of the law. He didn't tell Joshua to obey what you think you might need in the law. He said what? Obey all the law. This is what we need to do. We need to hear the word of the Lord this morning when he says obey all the law. We can't just pick and choose what we want to obey, church. We have to obey the book from beginning to end. We have to know it and obey it and live it in our lives. Number two this morning, he says, do not let the law depart from your mouth. Verse 8, do not let the law depart from your mouth. Again, go back to a passage in the Old Testament, Deuteronomy chapter 6, where we see that the law is being set down. And in Deuteronomy chapter 6, it talks about the fact that we are to meditate on the law day and night. We're to let it go. We're to have it on our lips in the morning when we get up, as we walk along the way, and when we lie down at night. Correct? This is what we are to do. We are to have this law on our mouth. And again, number three this morning in verse 8, it says meditate on it day and night. And this is where we need to take this in our time of devotion. In our time of prayer, we need to memorize the scripture. You don't have to take big chunks of chapters or anything like that, just a verse or two here and there, and just meditate on it. Let it sink into your head. In your time of devotion in the morning, do that. Just take a minute and let the word speak to you. We've been talking about in our small group Tuesday night Bible study, intimacy with God. How we grow closer to God in our relationship with him. And one of the things we've talked about is early morning Bible study and prayer time. Because David said, early in the morning, I seek you, Lord. There are many passages that talk about that. There's a passage in Mark where Jesus took off away from his disciples and away from the rest of the people. Early in the morning, he went to pray to his Father in heaven. I have children. Still, I have children in high school, one. And we try to do this every morning. We get up and take a few minutes to read some scripture and have prayer in the morning before she starts her day. And it's something that we've tried to do over the years as Michaela's grown up and gone on to college now. Maddie is still a sophomore, and we still do this. We read scripture in the morning. It's the best thing to do to start your day. I don't care when your morning begins, if it begins in the morning or afternoon or evening. Read some scripture. Be in the Word. Understand that when we do this, we grow closer to God. Amen? When we seek out God by being in His Word, I believe that's the best place to be. It's good to read books. It's fun to read some books. But folks, there's no greater book than the Word of God. There is no better way to know who Jesus is than getting into the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. There's no other way to understand how the church began than to read the book of Acts, to read what Luke wrote about Acts, about Paul and his missionary journeys, to understand that when he went from church to church, he was giving the message of Jesus Christ. There's no other way to understand our history as a people than to look at the Old Testament, to see the nation of Israel, how God used that nation to bring forth his Son, Jesus Christ, into the world. We want to read books and look at videos on how the world was made. There's no better way to find out how the world was made than to get into the book of Genesis. That was written by God. He was there. He's the one that spoke it into being and put it into word, Genesis chapter 1. In the beginning, right? God created the heavens and the earth. That's where it is. That's where we need to be. If we want to know about God, if we want to grow closer to God, if we want to get to know more about Jesus Christ, his Son, and what he did for us on Calvary, we need to be looking in the book. We need to have intimacy with God, church. If we are the church, if we belong to Jesus Christ, what does he want from us? He wants us to grow in him. He wants us to know him. He wants us to fall deeper in love with him. And we can only do that by meditating on his word. Keeping the word in our mouth. Keeping all the law, not just some of it, all of it. God uses his word to encourage us and help us not to be afraid. But we see here also that when we are immersed in the word of God, that we will also be prosperous and successful. You see that in this passage of scripture this morning? I've seen where Joshua chapter 1 verses 7 and 8 have been used before when talking about finances, when talking about money. Because more than once, God tells Joshua, if you follow my word, if you follow my leading, you will be prosperous and successful. Church, if we are holding on to the Lord, if we are following his life, reading his word, we will be prosperous and successful. This is not a self-help clinic. It's not a way for you to make more money. But I'm telling you from God's word what he says. We're walking in the way, holding on to him, reading his word daily, following him, we will be prosperous and successful. And when we are following God's law, we will have nothing to fear. God finishes his encouragement to Joshua this morning in chapter, in verse 9, rather, when he tells him again, do not be, what's the word there? Terrified. Right? Again, for God to say this, for him to use this language, there must have been something in Joshua that was holding him back. We never see where he says to God, no, I can't leave these people. I don't want to do that. We see where when Moses was chosen to lead the nation of Israel, what did he say? I can't talk, God. But of course, we knew he could. But God said, you know what? If you're going to play it that way, I'll give you your brother, Aaron, to help you. We can't give God excuses and say, you know what, I can't do this. God says, oh, okay, I'll go find somebody else. He works in us. He works through our fears. He works through our disabilities. He will use us to get the job done. Folks, most of you know me. Most of you know that I'm legally blind. I don't drive. There's a lot of things I can't do. I have to get up real close to see things. I have to work real hard to put a sermon together, type in, you know. But I've never once complained. I've never once said, you know what, God, I don't know if this is for me. I've been in the business world. I've worked in radio for 10 years plus. And God finally led me back to where he wanted me to be all along. Church, I'm telling you today as an example of what God can do. He can use you. He can use you. And he says to you this morning, just like he told Joshua, do not be terrified. Do not be discouraged, for the Lord your God will be with you, but wherever you go. We don't have to fear, because God is with us. God will use us. Doesn't matter what is going on. Trust the Lord to work in your life. Trust the Lord to be there in times of trouble. Trust the Lord to lead and guide through the storms of life. We talked about a storm last week where the disciples were waking Jesus out of the back of the boat because he was asleep. And the storm had come up. You know, we talked about that story, about where he got up and finally said, peace be still, and the waves and the wind died down. There's another time where we see Jesus in the boat. I'm going to end with this morning, where it's the disciples in the boat, and they see Jesus across the way, and he begins to walk on the water. You remember the story? Yeah. And he invites Peter. Bless Peter's heart. What a mess. The kids use that word today, you know, hot mess. That was Peter. Peter was a hot mess. He was a hot mess. And he would constantly put his foot in his mouth. He was constantly saying and doing something. And you're going, oh. Peter, no. But yet, Peter was doing it. He got out of the boat. He had more courage than any of the rest of the men. He got out of the boat and he stepped onto the water. If you believe what the Bible tells us, Peter walked on the water. And he began to walk toward Jesus. And then something took over and Peter began to think, wait a minute. What am I doing? I'm walking on water. And as soon as he did this, took his eyes off Jesus. What happened? He began to sin. He began to realize, hey, this isn't right. I can't do this. And as soon as he had those thoughts, he sank. And he had to cry out for Jesus to help. Church, many of us have been in that very same situation. We are sinking in our sin. We are sinking in the struggles of life. We are sinking in the wind and the storms that brew around us every day. And we need to focus our eyes on Jesus Christ. The Bible says he is the author and perfecter of our faith. The opposite of fear is faith. When we are going through the struggles of life, we need to hang on to our faith. When we are taking on more than we think we can bear, like Joshua, taking on the leadership of the nation of Israel, we need to hang on to our faith. We need to know that God can do anything. He can do anything. He said, in your weakness, I am strong. In our weakness, God will pull off a miracle. In our weakness, God will bring it out. We just need to focus our eyes on Jesus. finish it there with Joshua. He said, I am with you wherever you go. He gave the disciples, Jesus did the same words. Years and years and years later, when he's getting ready to leave this earth, after he had come and taught and was crucified and rose again, he's getting ready to leave, Jesus is. And he says, what? He says, go. Go and make disciples, teaching them everything I have commanded you, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And guess what? I will be with you to the very end of the age. Many times the Bible tells us God is with us. We need only to focus on Him. We trust in this one. We're going to come to our time of decision this morning, and we're going to be singing a great song, and Love Lifted Me. And love has lifted us if we have put our faith and trust in Jesus Christ. The love of Jesus has lifted us out of our sin, has lifted us out of the destruction that Satan has planned for us. But like Joshua, we can overcome. We can be leaders. We can serve in the church. We can be leaders in our family. We can be leaders at work simply by trusting in Jesus Christ. If we put our faith and trust in Him, bringing our lives to Him through faith, confessing Him before men, repenting of our sins, becoming immersed in the waters of baptism, and living a faithful Christian life, we can overcome. We don't have to fear anything. This morning I encourage you to continue, Christian, to live a life of faith, to cling to our Father in heaven, and to the love that Jesus has for us. If you haven't made that decision this morning, I encourage you to come now. Bring your life to Jesus Christ. He will make a difference. We're going to stand in just a moment and have our decision to have Love Lifted Me. But before we do that, we're going to have a word of prayer. But won't you please stand as we bow together? Our Father in heaven, we come before you in the name of Jesus. Again, encouraged and strengthened by what we have seen and heard from your word this morning. I feel encouraged, just as Joshua did, as he began to take on the leadership of the nation of Israel. Father, our jobs and our tasks may not be that big, but to us, they may seem monumental. Father, I pray that you would be with us as a family, be with us as a church. May we continually love and obey you. May we continue to be in your word, to be encouraged that we can do all things through Christ who gives us the strength. Father, we thank you for this time of instruction this morning. Thank you for the time of worship to be able to meet around the table. God, we lift up our voices to you once more this morning in worship. Pray that you would guide us this week as we go out into our lives. It's all because of Jesus. And it's in His name we pray. Amen. Let's have our decision this morning. Love lifted me. We'll sing all three verses.